Daniel Winnick on behalf of Mr. Hathaway, and I'll do my best to save 2 minutes for rebuttal. In order to plead a sufficient claim, Mr. Hathaway had to allege that the defendants interfered with his presentation of a non-frivolous argument, and that they did so either intentionally or with deliberate indifference to his rights. His complaint clearly meets that standard. First of all, the defendants have never disputed that depriving an inmate of his legal papers is the kind of act that can interfere with the inmate's right of access to the courts. Under Silva, active interference is any barrier that impedes the right of access of incarcerated persons, and taking away the inmate's legal papers is certainly such a barrier. The only question
here... Well, it's not really taking away. It was really more of a question of not providing it to him in time for the hearing, right?
Well, defendants have drawn the distinction to which I gather Your Honor is averting, which is the distinction between acts and omissions. But with respect...
I thought I had invented the question myself.
With respect, Your Honor, I don't think that distinction can matter. And the reason it can't matter is that it would allow... This is an example we can...
Well, interference sounds like a deliberate act. So if you sort of accidentally run your car into a telephone pole, slippery, no thought necessarily, slippery on a telephone pole, and that stops the streetcar from going, and that means people don't get to work on time. I think people wouldn't view that as interference. I think that would, whereas if you lay down in front of the tracks or detonated the did something deliberate to stop the car, that would be interference. Isn't that what happened here? Is more like the accident?
So we agree, Your Honor, that a purely negligent act would not constitute interference or would not give rise to liability. That isn't what happened here with respect to Mr. Hathaway's complaint clearly alleges that the defendants acted not negligently, but with either intent or deliberate indifference to his rights.
Why does he have to support that?
He has to support that the fact that he repeatedly pointed out to the defendants that he needed the legal papers. He repeatedly made that very clear to them. He did everything they asked him to do, and the papers still didn't wind up on the bus. The First Circuit said in Simmons, a complaint that alleges repeated notice to prison officials, repeated notice that he needs the papers, that they're important for pending legal proceedings, is sufficient to allege intent. A jury could find, if he were to prove those facts at trial, that the defendants acted with intent or with deliberate indifference to his rights. We're not saying that finding would be required as a matter of law, that that's the only plausible inference from the facts, but it's certainly a plausible inference. The other distinction, there are two distinctions that I think were inherent in your question. One is between negligence and intent or deliberate indifference. The other is between acts and omissions. As for the acts omissions distinction, we don't think that can be legally relevant because it would allow, for example, as we say in our reply brief, it would allow a prison officer in the mailroom to simply choose not to put legal files in the mail, to let them pile up on his desk, and that clearly constitutes interference that should be actionable as a denial of access to the courts. So that's...
Frankly, while I find all this interesting, it seems to me that you have a really difficult problem with regard to causation and prejudice. So perhaps you want to address that.
Yes, Your Honor. So the actual injury standard of Lewis versus Casey is a standing question. It's purely a question of who is a proper plaintiff to bring an access to courts claim. All you have to do to allege actual injury is allege that you suffered some personal hindrance in the presentation of an argument to the court. That's what the court of Lewis says.
There was more than one preclusive court of appeals case at the time that he was arguing before the trial court. He did make the argument sufficiently to preserve it, as I understand it, for appeal. Is that right?
That's right.
So, and there's no way he could have prevailed in the trial court. There's just none, no matter what he said.
Your Honor, assuming that's right, that goes to the question of remedy. And I agree that if this case goes to trial and he can't...
Why does it go to remedy? I thought it goes to the second prong of the Lewis standard.
It does not, Your Honor. And this is, I think, as you pointed out, the crux of the case. The Lewis standard is solely about whether you are a proper plaintiff to bring the suit. It is not about whether you can actually recover monetary damages. And if you want evidence of that, look to this court's decision in Hepp versus Plyler, which involved a prisoner who was directly appealing his criminal conviction. His counsel filed the California equivalent of an Anders brief, saying there are no non-frivolous issues. He, therefore, had the right to file a pro se supplemental brief. The prison was on lockdown. He couldn't get to the law library. He, therefore, didn't file the pro se supplemental brief. And the court said, that's actual injury. Now, in making that analysis, it did not look to whether the pro se supplemental brief, had he been able to file it, would have succeeded in obtaining reversal of his conviction.
But it has to be non-frivolous in the relevant sense, it seems to me. And the relevant sense has to be, would it have made any difference in the context in which he was trying to do this? I mean, and it wouldn't have. I mean, non-frivolous in the abstract, because he might be able to get to the Oregon Supreme Court, just seems totally irrelevant.
Well, Your Honor, arguments that are foreclosed by precedent are not frivolous, and it's for a good reason.
Well, they're not frivolous in one sense, but for this purpose, it seems to me it is frivolous.
But, Your Honor, I don't think the court can make a court-by-court distinction in terms of frivolousness. I gather Your Honor is suggesting...
Is there anything more that he could have done in the trial court than what he already did, which is to preserve the issue for consideration of appeal? Could he have won on this point if he had been really eloquent and had all his cases? Could he have won in the trial court?
Assuming the trial court was aware of the Oregon Court of Appeals precedent, which I think is would be a relevant fact, the answer is no, he couldn't have. But again, I think that goes only to his ability to recover actual damages.
Why doesn't that then distinguish, though, the cases, in particular the case you were just describing, where somebody was foreclosed altogether from gaining access to the court? That seems to me to be a relevant distinction here. As my colleagues have been pointing out, he did enough in the trial court to preserve whatever argument he wanted then to pursue up the chain. And I think your argument is, well, sure, there was an intermediate court of appeals decision that was a barrier, but perhaps he could have persuaded that court to reverse course. Perhaps he could have taken it all the way to the Oregon Supreme Court. It seems to me nothing that the defendants in this case did would have had any impact on those available routes.
Two points, Your Honor. First, I do think he could have gotten something from the trial court that would have paved the way to a smoother appeal later on. The trial court could have said, I recognize I'm bound by this precedent, but I disagree with it. The Oregon Supreme Court should consider it, and so forth. Second,
what difference would that have made?
Your Honor can speak much better than I can to whether that comment would have any influence on an appellate court, but I think it might. But secondly, I think as to whether he was able to present the argument, our position is that...
Sorry, you think...
No, I think in the...
I can't imagine what you have in mind.
I think in the Oregon Supreme Court, which is a court of discretionary jurisdiction, the fact that an experienced trial judge had expressed that the opinion was probably wrong could make a difference in the likelihood of the courts taking up the case. I want to make sure I reserve the balance of my time, but let me briefly...
But they did take up the case.
The Oregon Supreme Court has not taken up the case.
Oh, I'm sorry, the Oregon Supreme Court.
Yes, exactly, which is a court of discretionary jurisdiction where they would have to decide on the importance of the issue and so forth.
Was there a petition filed?
There was a petition filed in Mr. Hathaway's third appeal in this case, the appeal from his resentencing, which was denied. Briefly, to answer Judge Wofford's question, our position is he was not able to present the argument, not that he somehow could have presented it more extensively or done better. And the reason we say that is the court in Bounds said it's not enough that you get to say something to a judge unless you have authorities to back it up. You can't rely on trial judges knowing.
Well, I understood, tell me if I'm wrong on this, I understood the petitioner, or plaintiff, I guess, to have been able to make the argument in the sense that it was preserved for subsequent appellate review. Are you saying that because he didn't have his papers, he couldn't even do that?
It was preserved for subsequent appellate review, but our position is he wasn't able to present the argument to the court by presenting the court with reasons. I'm not saying that would necessarily have made a difference to the court's sentence.
But from a causation standpoint, why doesn't that just end the case right there? Because because it's not like the case where the person was foreclosed from filing anything, and so therefore, absent relief, you know, there would be no preservation of anything. He did enough, and probably all he could have done vis-a-vis the appeal in the trial court, even without the papers.
Because, Your Honor, the actual injury standard at this point is simply a question whether he is a gadfly plaintiff, whether he's somebody who hasn't actually suffered any personal hindrance in his access, or whether he has personally suffered that hindrance, in which case it's a proper plan to proceed. I see my time is out. Thank you.
Okay. We'll hear from the other side.
May it please the Court, Shaw for the U.S.C. defendants. I think that the Court has properly identified the sort of dispositive issue in this case, which is whether or not a plaintiff has sufficiently alleged an actual injury. And the facts, as the Court, I think, understands, is he, in fact, preserved his claim. He made his argument. He was represented by counsel on appeal, asked the Court of Appeals to revisit his precedent. They declined to do so. He filed a petition for review. The Oregon Supreme Court declined to revisit that. I don't see how in the absence of the claim violation, plaintiff could have done any more.
I will confess I didn't look at it, but did the Oregon Court of Appeals, in this plaintiff's case, when they got the case on appeal, did they suggest, you know, well, if only he had, you know, made a more fulsome argument below, maybe we would have come out differently? Was there any suggestion that what he had done to preserve the issue wasn't fulsome enough?
The Oregon Court of Appeals affirmed without opinion, so we don't know that. But what I do know is that the briefs in this matter are a matter of public record. And in response to his brief that was filed by counsel, my office did not argue that he failed to preserve it. We conceded that he preserved the argument, and we engaged on the merits. So
affirmatively said that he had preserved it.
Yes, I think the words that we said is that defendant appears to have preserved his arguments.
But the first issue is a little troubling that the prison guards are tasked with doing this. He repeats it, he does it over again, and he still doesn't get his papers in court. I mean, prisoners are sort of the prisoners. They don't have control over many aspects of their lives. Has your office done anything to inquire into why that happened?
Not that I'm aware of, Your Honor. The record shows in Mr. Hathaway's complaint that they responded to his grievance by saying that they implemented some active property log procedures. I don't know anything more than that.
I'm sorry, they said what?
In following these events, Mr. Hathaway filed a grievance with the Department of Corrections. He alleges this in his complaint, and he said that the response that he got from the Department of Corrections is that they've tried to remedy the issue by implementing some new procedures that they call an active property log. I don't know anything more than that, and there's nothing more than that in the record.
I would think that your office would be troubled by that kind of thing and would be interested in contacting the prison authorities to make sure that stuff like that doesn't happen all the time. It's some pretty important stuff.
I don't disagree, Your Honor, regarding the importance of ensuring access to courts. My office, the Department of Justice, typically my division doesn't typically get involved in the day-to-day workings of the Department of Corrections. It may be that they have.
But you must have colleagues who do.
Yes, Your Honor.
And you talk to them?
I certainly can relay your concern, Your Honor.
Now you talk to Attorney General, but this is something that ought not to be happening.
I will be sure to relay that concern, Your Honor.
Attorney General?
Yes, Your Honor.
And he has authority, right?
I believe she does. She certainly can talk to somebody about it. Yes, Your Honor. If the court has no further questions, thank you.
You have you out of time. Would you like to take a minute or four?
Let me just briefly take one more run at actual injury. I would urge the court to look again at have Judge Friedman's concurrence specifically points out the issue we've been discussing. Judge Friedman's concurrence in that case says, I recognize this complaint can proceed. It shouldn't have been dismissed. I'm skeptical that the prisoner can actually recover because I don't think he can show he would have obtained the reversal of his conviction. But that goes solely to the question of damages, not to whether the complaint can proceed. The Tenth Circuit's decision in Simpkins versus Bruce is very similar. There, the prisoner had not gotten his mail for a year. He missed the opportunity to participate in summary judgment briefing. The district court in that case granted judgment for the defendant, saying he wouldn't have won anyway had he been able to participate in summary judgment briefing. And the court said in order to allege actual injury to proceed on access to court's claim, you don't have to prove a case in that case.
That seems like a very formulaic way to proceed, because to look at the frivolity question in the abstract and not in the context of what difference it could have, the deprivation could have made, is just to spin wheels, because you're going to get to the same point later down the line, right?
I don't think it's an empty distinction. I think it is a question of standing versus the merits. And I do think there is a consequence to saying Mr. Hathaway doesn't even get the opportunity to take discovery to prove his claim. He can recover nominal damages in this case if the court finds that his constitutional rights were violated. The fact that he can't recover actual damages if, in fact, he wouldn't have obtained a shorter sentence is not the end of this case. And I think it would be of great value to Mr. Hathaway to have a court say, your rights have been violated. I award you $1 in nominal damages. You could get a declaratory judgment.
We could say that right now. Then we could say, but you didn't, on prong one, but on prong two, you lose.
But on prong two of what standard, I'm sorry?
Lewis versus Casey and so on.
Well, but prong two, again, I think is a standing inquiry. It is a threshold question.
That, but in terms of he would feel good if he knew that we thought his rights were violated, that there's nothing to preclude us from doing that if that's what we thought.
But I'm saying, Your Honor, he is standing to proceed to get to a final judgment, to have a judgment that his rights were violated. And if at the end of the day he can't recover actual damages, if he's limited to recovering nominal damages, then so be it. But that is still a judgment of value to him, and I don't think it means that the complaint should fail at the outset because he's not a proper plaintiff.
There was at the end of the brief, I think, some request to remand for amending complaint or anything relevant that could have been amended.
On the active interference question, Your Honor, there are considerations. On the actual injury standard, I think the only thing he could add to the complaint in theory would be any fact showing that the trial judge was not aware, might not have been aware of the Oregon Court of Appeals precedent, such that he actually could have obtained a shorter sentence. I'm not suggesting he necessarily has such facts, but those facts would be relevant. I think even if the court doesn't think there's anything he could add, the court said in Law of Secret Service and in Long versus Ingenio, which is an unpublished decision, that the leave to amend standard is one for the district court to apply in the first instance, and that for this court to do it would usurp the district court's authority. And for that reason, I think the court should remand in any event for the district judge to conduct that analysis.
Thank you.
Thank you, Your Honor.
The case is submitted.